See, if I put a quarter in here, this will turn up a little bit. Great. Welcome, everybody. I am just thrilled to be here this morning. And here's your first surprise of the day. You got me. Pastor Eric. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, some people, other people going, oh, man, really? Yeah, I know. It's a disappointment when you have a substitute preacher because you come and you're looking forward to Pastor Eric, who's just like off the charts awesome, right? And so, but he is on a little mini vacation this weekend. He's out in Seattle. One beautiful place to be, by the way, if you've never been out there. My goodness, is that a nice place to be. And he's out there visiting his daughter, so he gets to get, you know, refreshed, a little bit, you know, uplifted. I'm sure he'll come back just full of spit and vinegar, whatever he's full of. We won't get there. But he is such a pleasure to listen to, so I know it's a disappointment for you that you come in and it's just you got the substitute teacher. Preacher. And so, but like right when those substitute teachers, you know, you come and they have one way or another that they're going to do the lesson, you know, they're going to be, wow, they're going to be dynamic and they're going to whip this class into shape. And you go, oh, you know. Then you have the one that comes through and they do the lesson plan. And you go, maybe we can get through that. Then you have the other one, right? You have the other substitute teacher and they come in and they just sit down at their desk. They just cross their arms and look at you. They tell you all to pull out your textbook and study chapter 16. And at the end of the class, we're going to have a little pop quiz, and I'm going to give it to your teacher so they can see what you did today. And everybody goes, ugh, man, this isn't good. We don't want that. So I'm thinking, what should I do as my substitute preaching here this evening? And I went with D, none of the above, because I'm me, and I'm not any of those, and I'm really not much of a teacher, and I'm certainly not much of a preacher. But one thing I am is a child of God. Yeah. Amen, right? Yep. And his spirit is in me. And I'm so thankful for this and just so amazingly appreciative that he picked me up and found purpose for me. And it was when he found purpose for me and enlightened me as to who we all are. It's just inspiring. And you cannot conceal that. You cannot keep that under a bed, right? You have to put that on a lampstand and let it shine. So we're going to be pursuing this today. We are going to have a great time. And Eric told me that, you know, shorter is better than longer. You know, I could do right. Yeah, y'all like that, right? We could just say, okay, be thankful, dismissed, right? And we're all out. But these people, these good people practice and do this. So we're going to certainly join them in worship this morning and the music and such that they do.
You're blaming me?
Here comes the Greyhound. So we're going to do this morning. We're going to have a great time of worship, praising the Lord for all that he's done in our lives, all that he's done in the past, what he's doing today, and what he's doing in the future. And I'm pretty sure you're all going to walk away just a little bit closer to the Lord than what you did when you walked in here today. And I also want to thank and welcome all the people out there in TV land that are watching maybe on Facebook or whatever social media we are. We are thankful that you're here today as well. And if you have a friend or somebody that you can call and say, hey, wait, you got to check this guy out, give them a call, have them check in, because we love you too, and it's just like you're here among us, and we are so thankful that you're all here today. So with that, I'd like to open a little prayer. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for each and every person that came here today, and thank you for everybody at home that has tuned in. Lord, we trust in you and your message, and I just pray, Lord, that you will let it just flow through me and find its target on each and every person that's here. We are so thankful for all that you've done in every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And with that, Michelle and the praise team. Yeah.
Oh, you do not want to point at Michelle today. So the youth had a all-nighter last night, lock-in, and she's been awake. I'm sorry, she's been awake
TMI.
All night long. So make sure you, as we sing today, you just stare at her and see if she makes it without falling asleep. Mid-song, just, it'd be funny. Sorry, baby, I love you. I'm going to pay for that later, big time. Okay, well, let's stand and let's sing some praises to our Lord, because he has made today, and guess what? It says that every day we will praise the Lord. So go ahead, Don. Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. we turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you, 'cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come and you way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to job. Well, look around at these beautiful people and say hello to your neighbor. They look so good today. And then you may have a seat. We'll play that video for you.
We're not, there we go. I think everybody's just shell-shocked right now. It's gotta be Christmas. Right?
I don't know what you're talking about.
No joke.
That is the joke.
Wow.
I figured I'd just put all the pressure on you to follow.
I think it's, now it seems like this is weird because Michelle wasn't at home last night. You're not telling a joke. She must be the one who writes your jokes for you.
They'd be way better if she wrote the jokes.
Good morning, everyone. It's great to see you all here. Good morning to everyone who's watching online or who will watch the podcast or the cast of this later on this week. We hope that Eric is having a fantastic time. I know he is out there in Seattle visiting Jenna, and we wish him a safe trip on the way back as well. But we are blessed to have a stunt Eric here this morning. We're so happy and looking forward to that message as well. Just got a few announcements for you. First of all, we are always looking for help in the children's ministry and in the nursery. It takes a lot of work to wrangle kids. But if that is a special, special gift, if you can do that, like Michelle can last night, all night long in the lock-in. That's if you were a youth and did that back in the day, you know the torture you put those adult volunteers through. So
that was strangle kids, not wrangle.
Strangle kids. It's terrible. And that's why you're not running the youth program with Michelle. But if you are one of those very gifted people who would be willing to spend some time and help out with the children, with the nursery, we sure would appreciate it. If that is you, please reach out to Jill at, I believe it's kids@thesurfsidefellowship.com. Let her know you're interested, and she can allay all your fears and get you all up to speed on what it takes to do that. It's really a good thing, and you know that you're doing a great job helping kids, the next generation, who are growing up to know God, know the Lord. So please consider it and sign up if that's something that you feel on your heart. We've got a couple of events coming up here. Wednesday the 7th, that is July the 7th at 6:30 p.m. right here in the Worship Center. There's going to be the first Wednesday prayer group, and so that group gets together and they learn the importance of prayer and knowing the Lord. So please, if you've got Wednesdays that you're looking for something to do, that would be a great thing for you to join in on. So again, that's Wednesday, July the 7th, 6:30, right here in the Worship Center. Ladies Friendship Luncheon coming up also on July the 7th. That's going to be at 1 p.m. at Beef O'Brady's in Port St. John. Open to all you ladies. Get together and fellowship after the 4th of July weekend. Come back and have a great time together over at Beef O'Brady's. And I'm sure it's going to be a great time. I hear it always is. I'm not a lady, so I can't go. So that's unfortunate. And then lastly, Surfside Vacation Bible School coming up. That's going to be Monday through Thursday, July the 12th through the 15th from 6 to 8 p.m. And that is open to children 5 to 12 years of age. And please, please, please pass the word. Get the word out because kids have a great time. They love getting together. They don't like being cooped up like they have been for past, year and a half, I guess, in a house for a lot of the time. So if you'd like for your child to attend or you would like for more information about it, we have information at the information table. And you can also reach out to the church office at any time. I believe that's 321-607-2111, if I remember that correctly. So again, please, please, please pass the word, get it out, because it's going to be a great time for those kids that week. And that's all I've got. So I am now going to pass this off to Rodney, who is here with another awesome message of inspiration. I love you guys. I hope you all have a fantastic week. We'll see you all later. Thanks.
There you go, sir. Thank you, Brian. Morning, Surfside.
Morning.
What are you guys thankful for today? Open-ended question. Everything. I'm thankful for life, breath, my wife. She makes me steak. I like steak. Hey, she keeps me happy, okay? Thanksgiving, thankfulness, being prayerful always, praying always. That's the subject for today. That's what Steve is going to go over today. I'm very, very thankful for a lot of things. I'm thankful for my life today. I'm thankful for being before you guys and being able to help share in Christ, our Lord Jesus' message to you and the rest of the world, even those out in TV land and stuff. I want to tell you a quick story. Back in the 70s, 79, I was around 15, 14 years old, and there was a real bad situation going on, being from Atlanta, where a lot of the children were going missing. And I was alive up during that time, one of the kids out playing, and I could have been wrapped up into that situation myself. And I can tell you, during that time in Atlanta, a lot of the mothers and fathers consistently watched out for each other and the children and different families and stuff. And it was very country home-like atmosphere. And there's barely probably like 300,000 to 400,000 people in all of greater Atlanta. So it was, I call it suburban urban country. And that's what I like. Even today, I like that type of living. But during that time, when that happened, it caused us to change quite a bit. We couldn't go out after a certain time, and everybody was pretty much on edge. But I'm very thankful and I'm very appreciative of the law enforcement, the mothers and the fathers and the families, and the different churches that sought to keep us all as safe as possible. If it hadn't have been for the community, law enforcement, and even the government during that time, I probably wouldn't be here before you right now, because I was one of those children that could have been caught up in that situation real easily and stuff. Didn't happen too far from where I lived. So I'm thankful for being here before you guys today. One of the other things I would like to be thankful about, and I am thankful about, and hopefully will continue to be thankful about, is being with my wife and laughing about silly things. We laughed on the way here. We were laughing this morning about stuff. Being close to somebody, whether it's family, friend, or a neighbor, and to have that joy, to be thankful, just to have a little bit of joy is a wondrous thing. And not letting the negative Nellies in the world bring you down around every moment of the day. That one rotten apple that's in that barrel, don't let it spoil you. Just don't do it. You can find negativity around any corner. But guess what? That's only one apple in that whole barrel that's bad. There's a whole bunch of good ones in there too. So there's plenty of joy to go around for everybody. And they all taste good. One last thing I want to read to you. This is from 1 Thessalonians 5:16 through 18. And this is a family prayer or a family statement that I've always said to my wife and I when we've basically been together for, over 22 years right now. I've always said, pray continually, be thankful. And 1 Thessalonians says, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Pray continually and always be thankful. It's very simple. Each and every day we got to die a little bit to ourselves, and give it to Christ, give it to God, no matter what the circumstances. And I'm telling you, you will always find that joy. Because I've had some crazy things happen to me, and I turn around and go, I don't know what you're doing, Lord, but hey, I trust you. And the next day comes around, and I look back, and I go, wow, thank you. Now I see the greater wisdom of your ways. Now, it's not going to always be revealed to you in the moment and at the time. But there's always a plan. And be thankful that we have the ability today to have that plan or that guide revealed to us through his word, through his son, Christ Jesus, while it can still be found. Because it seems like a lot of people and a lot of institutions are trying to stamp it out. Don't let the rotten apple spoil the rest of the good ones that are in our barrel. So on that note, let's say a quick prayer. Thank you, God, for your son, Christ Jesus. Thank you for the message of being thankful to you in all that we do and all that we say. Please keep us, lead us, and teach us, and help us to always understand that you will be there by our side as we travel throughout our lives until that one day when we meet again in heaven. In Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Rodney. You know, while you were talking about that story about the Atlanta children, it made me think of Psalms 27:1, where the Lord says, The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Do we walk like that every day? Just knowing that we're sort of invincible. You know, we got the God of the universe on our side. You ever think about that? So let's stand, and we're going to sing a song that falls right into that same category. That is Your Love Defends Me. Here we go. Y'all can sit down for this last song. And I hope you will just make it your prayer for this service. Like the Holy Spirit would be here and he would use the words that Steve would share with us to make a change in our life. You know, this isn't like just going to the grocery store every week so you stay alive. We're supposed to be changing becoming more like Christ every day, every year. We should think about that. You know, are we different this year than we were last year and the year before that? Are we getting closer to the image of Christ? So let's pray this song that God would move on us in the service. And we're going to walk out of here a little different, a little closer to Jesus than we walked in. There's nothing worth more that would ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. In your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, and my heart becomes free, and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord, Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you for singing. And you're already seated. There you go.
My heart is crying, 'cause I was made to come to you. So I
So, let's be real. Some days are hard. So I made this. List of awesome things I'm thankful for. Yeah. Sometimes I need reminding that things are not all that bad. So I wanted to share a few, because you guys are my friends. It's great to be alive. And here's some reminders why. First one, bubble wrap. When cats do their tongue, like this. I'm also thankful for the little paw pads like the cats and dogs have and the sound it makes. Paw pads. I love them. Hey, turn that back on. Oh, no. Change it. Ah, there, that's better. Music is magical. It can make anything better. Right music can make a video better. The same goes with life. Singing. I like paw pads. Singing. If something's boring, just sing it, and that will make it better. Watching paint dry. It's really cool. Old people who still hold hands. Clouds that look like stuff. One time I saw a cloud that looked like an airplane, and I realized it was an airplane. Imagination. Without it, we wouldn't have airplanes, no internet. Pants. We gotta wear them, because if we didn't, it'd be sort of awkward. Pants. Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. Flee. Clothes with funny names, like Windbreaker. Birthday cake. No reason at all cake, just cake. Sorry if we filmed this while I was hungry. Forgiveness! I'm confessing if I ain't perfect. Ain't a word. We all mess up, come on. Don't mess up and forget to forgive all the mess ups. Thankful plants undergo photosynthesis, using the energy from the sun to convert carbon dioxide to oxygen, providing us with the air we need to do things like this. I'm bored. Morgan Freeman's voice. Hello, I'm Morgan Freeman. I'm working on it. My voice is changing, but it hasn't changed that much. Food, taco, burger. I know, I already said food, but this is my list and my rules. Happiness. Sadness. Sad isn't bad. It helps you know what you care about. People. Sometimes people can be really people-y, but we need each other. Life's better with people in it. Family, friends, you. Just being alive. Sometimes we forget how it's just great to be alive. We're breathing. Some days are tough, but we got a lot to be thankful for. We just have to look for it sometimes. They say if you have food in your fridge, clothes on your back, and a place to sleep, you're richer than 75% of the world. I did not know that. So what would you add to the list? Let me know. Share this video with someone you're really thankful for. Oh, and of course, also this. Dancing!
Hey, this is Pastor Eric. I'm obviously not in town this weekend. We're visiting Jenna. Steve McCoy will be sharing with you. I hope you will give him even more respect than you ever give me. Laugh at his jokes, tell him he's funny. But enjoy your time. Get something out of this weekend. Hey, take notes. I expect there's going to be a quiz when I get back. All right. Love you guys. Steve, you're going to do great, man. We'll talk to you soon. Bye.
Wasn't that a great video? That was so sweet. When Pastor Eric and I were putting this message together a couple weeks back, it was one of the things that we just really weren't sure exactly how it was going to pan out. And he always finds these awesome videos to put in front of the message. And so as we were putting and screened this particular video, it just screamed at us. It says, oh, this is too cute. We've just got to use this. So as we continue in the series of pastors leading us in, we're in the Praying Always series. And we're looking at simple patterns to apply to our prayer lives, right? And he's used the acrostic ACTS. A-C-T-S, right? And A that we've covered a couple weeks ago is adoration. And then a couple weeks ago, he presented confession. Then we took a little time out for Father's Day. We had a nice Father's Day service, didn't we, the other week, right? That was nice, the butterflies and the bacon. Well, I didn't get any bacon, but a lot of people got bacon, so that was really good for them. And then, of course, we get to Thanksgiving and supplication. So today we are talking about Thanksgiving and how we might apply that to our prayer pattern. Now, first, I have a little question for y'all, and I'm pretty sure I already know a lot of hands are going to shoot up on this, but who has gone on a cruise Anybody been on a cruise before? Yeah, most of us have, right? And going on a cruise can be such an exhilarating vacation. Dollar value, it's hard to beat it for dollar value for a vacation, places to go, things to see, et cetera, et cetera. But there can be challenges with that and discouragements and things that we don't really see coming until they're in our lap. But when we do that, right, we get our tickets and we get on board and we go through the whole process and we get finally into the ship. And we step into this ship, and it's palatial, right? It is so pretty, it's so gorgeous, and it just takes our breath away. Well, what do most of us do next? Beeline to the buffet, right? And guilty, right? Because I just know there are 2 or 3 dozen shrimp waiting to be in my belly, right? Yeah, absolutely, and that's what a lot of people do. So you end up, you go up there, and you gorge yourself as though this is the only meal you're going to have for the next week, even though dinner is all but 3 hours away. But you don't care, you know, living carefree now for the moment. But you're going then through you walk around the ship a little bit, and then it comes to about 3 or 4 o'clock, right? And what happens at around 3 or 4 o'clock? You hear the big whistle go, and it's time to muster for the emergency drill. Now, once upon a time, we used to have to go to our staterooms and gather these little beauties, right? And we would put these little beauties on, and we would button them up. And of course, emergency drill, you can't use the elevators. So now you gotta either go up all the steps or you gotta go down all the steps. Then you go out to the promenade deck where everybody's gathering for their emergency drill. Now, while you're out there, all of a sudden, there is no more personal space recognition. You are tight and tight and tight as though, you know, personal space, certainly not COVID, right? Anyway, so we're out there and we're doing this. Now, somebody thinks it's important that we know what these are for. And so they're going to explain to us exactly how we should wear them, how they should be attached. And even though this one isn't an expensive one, the ones you have on the ship have the little light, right? And they also have the little whistle. And then they explain that the light isn't really to attract sharks. And in case the shark misses, you can blow the whistle and say, come on back, you missed me, right? But no, no, no. And so you finish all that and you go back on and then you continue on to your cruise. Now, I have to share with you a little story of mine. It was about my first cruise, and it was very nearly our last cruise because it was a Murphy's Law type of cruise where pretty much everything that could go wrong does go wrong. So, first thing we did, made the stupidest mistake. One, we didn't talk and ask anybody about what we should do, and we booked the cheapest little cruise we could get because we thought, well, we just want to try it, you know, just 2 or 3 days. What if we don't like going on for a week? You know, what if we don't do it? And so we kind of like went the low road. So we got a cheap little cruise, and we drove all the way down to Miami to get on this thing, and then we get there, and in Miami, in the port, there's all these massive ships, right? And then we find ours, and it's like that littler one over there, and I want to go in big ones, right? But we didn't. That was what we booked. So we get onto this thing, and we go through the whole process, and we finally get onto the ship, and once we get on the ship, it opens up, and it's, yeah, this is pretty nice. This could work out. And so we go, and we do the muster drill and everything, and we're about to set sail. And then it becomes Gilligan's Island. Dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun. The tiny ship was tossed, right? The seas and the weather start changing. And we can see the ocean, and it's going like this. And our little ship is like surrendering already, and it's still tied up to the dock. And we're thinking, oh, man, this isn't going to be too good. But we don't care. You know, we'll just muscle through all this. So we do this, and then we get to the buffet, right? Because I'm going to get and these shrimps are just waiting for me. And we get there, and it's like, hot dogs, hamburgers, frozen pizza, cold french fries. Really? This isn't like the pictures. And so we're disappointed there. And so then it's time for us to cruise and go around the ship. We check out our stateroom. Well, our stateroom is a gross exaggeration. We open the door. Oh, I'm not kidding. This gets better and better, folks. We open the door, and literally our stateroom is about 10 by 10. How small was it? It was so small that where the bed was, you couldn't walk up beside the bed. You had to get in and out of the bed over the foot of the bed. Oh yeah, gets better. You go into the bathroom, right? Using the bathroom, you can literally use the bathroom, brush your teeth, and take a shower at the same time. Tiny, 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 tiny. So we're disappointed, and now we're out on the ocean. You know, that's since then it's left the dock, and we're in the Straits of Florida, what they call the Straits of Florida as you get down the East Coast. And it's bumpy, and it's stormy. And you're walking down the hall, and the hall's going up, and you're walking up, and the hall's going down, and you're walking down. And then it goes a little this way and a little this way. This is just not pleasant. So we get to dinner, and... We get to dinner, and dinner is maybe at best like a mediocre high school cafeteria lunch. This is just like, this is just not going our way. So we go, okay, we'll just chill. And so we're going to go now to the entertainment. And in the entertainment, it's the headliner act, right? So this has got to be good, right? We've heard so much about the entertainment on these cruises. So we get out there, and it's like the Rhinestone Cowboy steps out on stage. From South America. And he's got a sombrero and he's got all these things and the sparkles and stuff. And what does he pull out? He pulls out a string about this long. And on each end of it is like this little ball. And he holds it in the middle. And he holds it in front of him. And he goes, clacky, 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 clacky. The ball's going up and down and up and down. This is the entertainment. Oh, but he was good at this. He was like the clacker meister, right? He could do it over his shoulder, behind his back, between his legs. He could swing it around like a lasso, right? He could throw it over his shoulder like a, no, something. But he could do all these amazing things with this. But I'm looking at my wife and go, seriously? So we go, okay, this is just a bad day. Tomorrow we're going to be in port. Maybe tomorrow will be a better day. So we get to tomorrow, and we get back into our room, right? Now, if motion sickness doesn't capture you, when you're bumping around in the seas like a can, like beans in a can, it can be very relaxing. You can go to sleep and sleep like a baby in a cradle. And that's what happened to us that night. But all of a sudden, at about 4 o'clock in the morning, bam, 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 wakes up, right? Bam, bam, bam. We wake up, we spring over the foot of our bed. And our stateroom is filled with smoke. And it's like, whoa, wow. And bam, 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 you got to get out. So we throw on our bathrobes, and they usher us out to the side of the boat, and we're looking down the promenade, and what are we seeing? Everybody out there with their life preservers on and their jackets on. These people paid attention. And they have their medications and their toiletries in hand. And we're just thinking, maybe we should have paid more attention to that. A little fluffy, right? And so, soon enough, what ended up happening was there was a fire in one of the kitchens. And that triggered the alarms, and smoke drifted down through the ventilation system. And that's what triggered everything. So, of course, we were last to show up to the party. And so by about the time we were there, they said, okay, everything's under control. You can all return to your staterooms. Well, of course, now by this time, everybody's like wide awake. You think we're going to go into the drink, you know? Think, who knows what's happening next? And so they get dismissed. Now everybody's wide awake. Everybody's in the ship is wide awake. And they say, okay, go back. So we go, we want coffee. Not a drop of coffee to be had in the whole ship. Could have been a mutiny going on that night. I'm telling you what. But in any case, that was our first experience and nearly our last. And we ended up being convinced by some friends of ours, look, that was just awful. You know, next time, step up to the plate. If you're going to go on a cruise, go on a cruise. Take a week. Go into super liners. It's altogether different. And we followed his advice, and we've been cruising once or twice a year ever since, and I've never had any such experience again. So the question I have for you this morning is, do you sometimes struggle with disappointments and discouragement? We all do, and sometimes we can drown in discouragements and disappointments. Sometimes it can just take us so far off of our game that it's just a shame. And it can be from any number of things, right? It can be from relationships, it can be our spouse, it can be our kids, it can be our job, it can be our cars, it can be our health, it can be your neighbors, it can be any number of things. But why? Why do we struggle so? Oftentimes it's because we're out of alignment, right? Use your car, for example. Remember this? See the USA in your Chevrolet. Nothing. You get it. Somebody get it. Yeah, right. That was an old jingle. It was an advertising campaign from once upon forever ago. It's things that just stick. Other things, I can't remember a person's name, but I can remember the jingle of a Chevrolet commercial. But in any case, so use your car for an example, right? When it's in alignment, It drives nice. It's smooth sailing. It's fun. It's enjoyable, as long as maybe Eric's not in front of you or behind you. And so you're enjoying yourself and you're out there. But what happens when your car's not in alignment? Right? Your wheels are shaking and your steering wheel's shaking, right? And it's not fun at all, and it causes anxiety and discouragement and disappointment because, oh my gosh, how much is this going to cost? Is this going to break? Am I going to have to call somebody? Am I going to be broken down out here in the middle of nowhere? Well, likewise, spiritually, when we are out of alignment, we face disappointments, right? And discouragements. And why? Because we take so many things for granted. We become not thankful for so many of the blessings that we're so given, so handed to us. And the truth is, we are all guilty of taking things for granted, our blessings for granted. Use our bodies, for example, right? And I can see in this too, like there's many of us in about in the same season of life here. When we were young, right, we just took for granted all the millions of things that go on in our bodies 24/7, 365 that we just don't think about. It's not that we're malicious and just blatantly taking them for advantage, like, you know, like, oh, well, we don't need sleep and we can eat what we want and we can drink this and we can do that. And we can do that. No. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about things like our hearing. We don't miss our hearing until it fades. We don't miss our vision until we need glasses to see. And even then, you kind of, which way is this going? Oop, wrong pair. You know, things like that, right? Same thing with our sense of smell, the beautiful fragrances that we get to smell, and our taste, right? Depends what's going on in our lives, maybe medications or something. We lose our sense of taste, and that's awful. Maybe it's our knees. Maybe it's our backs. Maybe it's our kidneys. There are any number of things that we take for granted until they malfunction or they're not there to be what we just take for granted. So let's look at three things to be thankful for. Number one, what has God done in the past? We read from 1 Chronicles chapter 16. Remember, it's going to be a test on this. Pastor said, verses 7 through 16, where David's glorious psalm of thanksgiving provides us a blueprint of thankfulness. That day, David first appointed Asaph and his associates to give praise to the Lord in this manner. Give praise to the Lord, proclaim his name, make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him, sing praise to him, tell of all his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always. Remember the wonders he has done, his miracles, and the judgments he pronounced. You, his servants, the descendants of Israel, his chosen ones, the children of Jacob. He is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. He remembers his covenant forever, the promise he made for 1,000 generations, the covenant he made with Abraham, the oath he swore to Isaac. So we might ask, what's the celebration about? What's going on? What's the backstory here? Well, during the period of the judges, the Ark had been captured. The Ark of the Covenant had been captured by those pesky Philistines. And what happened in that time was that Israel and the Philistines are always fighting, right? They're always warring with each other. We win, they win, they just battle back and forth. Well, in this case, Israel had suffered a pretty substantial loss. So some brainiac thought, oh, I got a great idea. Why don't we go tote the ark into the next battle? And we know God is going to just step up to the plate and rescue us. Well, apparently they didn't consult God first. God had no part of it. So the next time they went into battle, they tote the ark up. The Philistines soundly stomp them. I mean, devastate them, capture the ark, and take the ark back to Philistine land. Right? So now they have this thing in Philistine land, and here's a lesson to learn. Careful what you wish for. You just might get it. And when you pray, be specific, or you end up with me. So when you pray, it's as important. It is important, right? So here the Philistines have the ark, and this is reminiscent now of what was going on in Egypt when God was like putting the plagues out, right, on the Egyptians, trying to get his people to get set free. But the Philistines have no part of it, so they're passing this thing around like a hot potato from one Philistine city to the other, and they're getting boils, and they're getting this and that, and they're being inspired not to sit down, and there's just all kinds of not good things happen to them. So they decide they're going to put this up in their temple with their other idols, because that, maybe that's where it would be happy. Well, God would have no part of that. So then over the night, God knocks down all the other idols, right? And these guys come in and they go, whoa, right? So what are we going to do with this now? And somebody smart goes, how about if we give it back? Let's give it back to them. So they put it, yeah, right, they do, right? Read it, it's in the Bible. And so they put it on a cart with a couple dairy cows, and they like pushing it, and they go off back to Israel, and they ended up wanders into Israel, and it ends up in Abinadab's house. And so don't know why it doesn't end up going further, but apparently that was God's will. So it sits there for like 40 years. And during that time, Saul has been king. And of course, King Saul, he's a train wreck, right? He's not about this. But then comes David. And David becomes king. And David has a heart for God. And David says, whoa, we got to get that back here, right? We got to get the ark. We got to get it in Jerusalem. We got to get into alignment to God's will. So they're all happy, and they send a team out to go get the... And then so they put it on a cart, and they have a couple oxen, and they're bringing it back. And then, of course, many of us know the story, right? Because this is like a woe story. And so the ox maybe trip up a little bit, and the cart wiggles a little bit, and it looks like the ark is going to fall off. And poor Uzzah, he's just there, and he's like probably reflexes. He goes, no, we can't do that. God strikes him dead for doing that. And David's like, whoa. How about if we stash this over in Obed's house for a while? So they stash it over in Obed's house for a while, and they go off and they fight some Philistines again. But in the meantime, they're getting into alignment. And they remember God's will on how the ark is to be carried on poles and organized and conducted by Levites. So David gets this orchestrated, and now, with great thankfulness for all that's happened in the past and what's going on in their lives right then and what their expectations are for in the future, they bring the ark into Jerusalem. So that is what's going on. So how might we reflect on how God has blessed us in the past and what we should be thankful for? Of course, there's many things, isn't there? We all have things from last week, last month, last year, 10 years, whatever. We could go back into the Bible, all the way back to creation. I'm pretty thankful for creation. I'm very happy we exist. And on top of that, in all of this magnificent creation that God made, he made us in his image. That's something to be thankful for, my friends. His image. Now, we can bunny hop forward, right? And we can be so thankful for Jesus and his work on the cross for us. We can be thankful for his resurrection, the empty tomb. We can be thankful for Pentecost and the Holy Spirit that comes to live with us. I like what Rick Warren has to say. Happy moments, praise God. Difficult moments, seek God. Quiet moments, worship God. Painful moments, trust God. Every moment, thank God. Those are words, friends. Number two, what he is doing today. My goodness, where do we start here, right? The Lord provides for us. He protects us. He provides our needs. He comforts us. And every day, he is pressing each and one of us into the very specific mold that he designed for us. Every day, he's pressing us into this mold. And that mold is to form us into the likeness of Jesus Christ. That's something to be thankful for, my friends. Let's look at this next verse. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Proclaim his salvation day after day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all peoples. For great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. You know, as God's people, we have a responsibility not only to be thankful for him, but to be thankful for all that he enables us to do in his place, right? There's a story I heard, and I got to make this really fast. Y'all need to listen quicker because we're already about out of time, and I've got another point to make. So I'm going to make this a really fast story. So I was reading in the news about 2 weeks ago, right? This guy, scuba diver, he's in Cape Cod. He's in Cape Cod, right? And he's underwater, and he's picking up lobsters off the bottom, and all of a sudden, whoosh, total darkness. And he thinks, oh my goodness, I've been eaten by a shark. But he doesn't feel any pain. And he doesn't feel any like big gnarly teeth or anything. And he's wondering what's going on. And it dawns on him, he has been swallowed by a whale. It's in the news, folks. And I immediately go to Finding Nemo, right? And Marlin and Dory just swimming around in this whale's mouth thinking, how are we getting out of here, right? And so he's fighting and struggling, and he hasn't lost his regulator, so he's still breathing in there, and he thinks for sure he's going to die. He thinks the next thing, because he can feel like the whale like trying to swallow him. And so he fights against it, and then all of a sudden, he feels the whale going up, and he sees daylight, and the whale shakes his head, and spits him out like old nasty bubble gum, right? And his buddy on the boat picks him up, and they're like, whoa, that was pretty awesome. You can bet that fella thought Lord was with him that day. He was pretty thankful for what he had done that day. So we should be thankful for things like that. Okay, point number three, and I got to go into fast forward. Looking forward to what God will do. Oh my goodness. Is there anything more inspiring than the hope we have in Christ and the expectation? And I don't mean hope like, gee, I hope we have shrimp on the buffet. No. I'm talking about our expectation, God's promises in the Word, of that we are going to be spending eternity with Him in heaven, where there is no pain, there is no discouragement, there is no point. You know, everything is just going to be unimaginably awesome. And that's the expectations that we have moving forward. And for that, we should be thankful, because those people who have not received Christ as their Savior do not have that expectation or that hope. And friends, we should be thankful for that every single day. So with that, friends, I'm going to close in prayer, because I've run out of time. Y'all really need to listen quicker. So if you join me in prayer, Lord, thank you for this opportunity to serve you. Thank you for each and every person that's watching at home, for every single person that here is with us today. Lord, I just pray that you will inspire us to be thankful for the things of the past that you have done for us, the things that you do for us today, and the things we look forward to in the future in being with you. And Lord, we are just so thankful for your love and your mercy and your grace, which is everlasting to everlasting. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Thank you. David.
Last line one more time.
God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
Are we back on? There we are. Now we're back on. Great. Awesome. Thank you, David. And thank you, Praise Team. What you do every week is really remarkable. Listen, I want to thank everybody for coming here today. I want to thank you folks at home for tuning in and staying tuned in to me. At least I hope so. And so I would just like to remind everybody that we don't pass the offering baskets around just yet, but there are baskets up front that if you would be so moved to donate today on your way out, we certainly appreciate that. And I would just like to close in prayer now. Lord, thank you for the opportunity to come together and worship you in this place with these people, such fine brothers and sisters we have in you, Lord. And we so appreciate all of them. And Lord, I just pray that as we move forward, that you will inspire us to pray in a way of adoration and to confess and lay our sins and our misgivings at your feet. And to be thankful for all the things that you give us, and to remind us to pray not only for others, but for all people, no matter who they are, no matter where they are. Lord, please protect Pastor Eric and bring him back to us safely. We so look forward to him and the works that you do through him. In Jesus' precious name we pray, amen. Thank you.